When you hear this sound, an anti-ableist permission slip tip will be offered and read aloud by my supervisor, Dr. J. Logan Smilges. It's your first day of class as an undergraduate student. You walk into a classroom and find an empty seat to sit down in. Your professor glides into the room and introduces the class by going through the syllabus page by page. Course readings, assignments, expectations. On the very last page, right after the section on the university's policy on religious accommodations, is the note on disability accommodations. The professor doesn't read this aloud, but gestures to it quickly, not wanting to call too much attention to it. You read through it and flip back to the first page. You're not disabled, although you will be soon. But for now, you make a note of it. Now you're in grad school. It's the first day of class. You've recently been diagnosed with a chronic illness. You flip through the syllabus before the professor arrives. Readings, assignments, and what's this? The disability accommodation statement has disappeared. In the other classes you attend later that week, only one syllabus briefly alludes to the professor's obligation to provide reasonable accommodations to students, but disability is never mentioned. You look around the classroom and wonder, where are all the ill and disabled academics at? I borrow this question from scholars Nicole Brown and Jennifer Lee, who posed this question in their work on ableism in academia. The case of the missing disability statement was something I've encountered as I've climbed higher through university. And what this signals to graduate students, I think, is that disabled people are not expected to be there. Or, perhaps to offer a more generous reading, that disabled graduate students must already be aware of these services, which is a problem if you come into disability or illness during your time at university, like I did. So, where are we? In this episode of Diagnosis Grad School, I talk to other past and current disabled grad students. I focus on two themes, time and accommodations. Time and accommodations are themes which pervade every student's university careers. How long should I expect this assignment to take? How long should I study for this exam? If I sent my professor a request for a paper extension, should I expect to be granted it? What if I get overwhelmed by something in my personal life? Will they listen, be receptive to it? And for the disabled student, these themes take entirely new forms as well. Disabled scholars face these sets of hurdles, and, as well, hurdles from their disabilities. We face internalized ableism, structural ableism, ableist attitudes from faculty, staff, or other students, health and job precarity, and financial inaccessibility, made all the more difficult by intersecting marginalized identities. Here's Jay Dolmage on this, offering up a metaphor of the steep university steps.
I think the steep steps puts forward the idea that access to the university is a movement upwards, that only the truly fit survive this climb. The steep steps lead to the ivory tower, and this tower is built upon standards. In many ways, I think this is an identity the university, above all other places, has embraced. I want to suggest that we've mapped the university in this way, as a climb up steep steps for particular reasons. The steep steps metaphor sums up the ways that university constructs spaces, processes, ideologies that exclude. The self or selves that have been projected upon the space of the university are not just able-bodied and normal, but supposedly exceptional and elite. The university is a place for the very able.
The university is a place for the very able. Disability scholar Margaret Price notes that disabled people in academic life seem to be struggling. This struggle often goes unnoticed and is frequently erased or pushed out of the university altogether. Academic life is also becoming increasingly disabling. Difficult teaching loads, limited tenure stream positions, and ever-increasing academic expectations are impacting faculty and student mental and physical health. Price began researching the everyday academic experiences of disabled faculty back in 2011, launching the Disabled Faculty Study, an 8-year project. I'll summarize just one aspect of her study, her discussion of the time needed by disabled faculty to get accommodations. What Price found was that access actually further marginalized disabled faculty. Quote, "One of the most important findings from the study is that access, as envisioned and practiced in the contemporary university, actually worsens inequity rather than mitigating it." Price offers up her theory of what she calls crip spacetime to explain why this happens. Quote, "This theory turns attention away from individual bodies, focusing instead on relations, systems, objects, and discourses. Accommodations," she adds, "relies on the assumption that disability is stable and knowable, not only in moments, for example, when confronting a step or a time limit or an uncaptioned video, but in predictive ways. Adaptation implies responding to an access need as it emerges. Accommodation implies, and in everyday academic life, almost always requires, the ability to say, I can tell you what I'm going to need in an hour, in a week, next semester. This, of course, is not how disability or illness works. Many conditions are fluctuating, unpredictable, or deeply unknowable. Crip spacetime asks three important questions. Who can identify their own access needs in an understandable manner? Who can predict what sort of accommodation they'll need tomorrow or next week? And who cannot? Price discusses the university accommodations process as a sort of loop. It's a time-consuming one, full of delays, stalling, demands for medical proof, and inappropriate suggestions. Disabled graduate students are also caught in these time-consuming loops, and we'll hear from one student later on this point. Graduate students occupy a weird space between being a student and an employee of the university. While producing research, most graduate students are typically expected to work as teaching or research assistants. And this weird space is where the accommodations loop strangles disabled students. I found myself ping-ponged between my department, HR, and the disability office, for example, when making access requests. University accommodations operate under a legal framework. That is, one's disability is not recognizable until medical documentation has been filed. And, as I've pointed out in previous episodes, getting this documentation can take a long time. And if you manage to pass this Herculean task, you're faced with perhaps the most duplicitous barrier of them all, the rhetoric of the reasonable. I talked to Evan, a lecturer at the School of the Art Institute of Chicago, about this weird rhetoric of reasonable accommodations.
So our accommodation note is like, SAC is committed to full compliance with all laws regarding equal opportunities for students with disabilities. And then they say, students with known or suspected disabilities, such as a reading writing disorder, ADHD, and or a mental health condition, who think they would benefit from assistance or accommodations, should first contact the DLRC. And they will then provide you both, that they will work with you after they review your disability documentation. They will then provide both you and your instructor with a letter outlining your approved accommodations, and they will work with you to determine your reasonable accommodations. And it's just like, the language is so, it's so to the law, right? And it's like, it's this kind of position where it's like, we don't have to, we're following laws and we're following like what we can consider reasonable.
And this rhetoric of what is reasonable splits disabled people into two categories, the accommodatable and the unaccommodatable. The people that I spoke to all had something in common. Many of their symptoms were unaccommodatable as graduate students. That is, some disabilities were easier to accommodate than others. Unaccommodatable disabilities might look like cognitive disabilities, unpredictable exhaustion or sleep disorders, pain, or fluctuating health conditions.
The thing is that, yeah, like that unaccommodatable, like what do you do when your student can't come in for like the first 2 hours? Like there were some times in undergrad where I'd be like 2 hours late, 2.5 hours late, right? Like, what do you do with that? How do you accommodate that, right?
I want to think through this question throughout the episode, the how do you accommodate that? It came up again and again in my conversations. It also came up for me. I had myself ask my access advisor if there was any way to arrange a couch or resting place to be placed in the seminar room, some place where I could recuperate but still participate. They suggested a yoga mat. I don't know if you've ever tried to have a conversation with someone whose eye-level gaze landed at your feet, but it's more than demoralizing. Evan did, in fact, have an official diagnosis, one for sleep disorders, but had no official documentation. They were still, though, able to graduate.
I relied on the goodwill of my teachers and my own desire to make sure I was always in communication about everything and like letting them know and letting them know and letting them know. And that's because that's the big thing I always tell my students is like, as long as you communicate with me what's going on, I will do everything I can to make sure that you have what you need.
If you're an educator, this is your anti-ableist permission slip, allowing you to grant accommodations to any student who requests them, regardless of institutional policy, because access should never be gatekept, and classes should never be governed by carceral punitive logics.
I talked to Corin next, a PhD student in the Department of Geography at my university, the University of British Columbia. I opened our conversation by asking a simple yet complicated question. What is it like being a disabled graduate student?
there's so much. There's so many ways to answer that. I think like the number one, like the primary emotion that I feel is just frustration. Frustration because it doesn't have to be this way, because so many of the barriers that we face as disabled graduate students are arbitrary and manufactured, and nobody seems to even know what the reasoning is behind them. And I think it's just because the reasoning behind them is ableism and trying to maintain an exclusive space through exclusion.
Corin tells me a story about an accommodation loop he got stuck in while TAing. He sets up the story by telling me about an access option his supervisor already had in place for all TAs.
So it was my first year back from medical leave, and my first semester back went great. I was TAing for my supervisor. We'd met before the course ever started. And, you know, here are some of the things that I struggle with. Here are some of the things that I think I might need. She offered a couple of other things that she thought might potentially be helpful with the things that that I struggled with. Particularly at that time, I was less than 6 months out from finally getting a diagnosis after 7.5 years of seeking a diagnosis. And so I was really very much still just getting a handle on my health and my needs. And there were things that she just made part of the TA ship, and it was never an issue. So one of the things that she did was, it's a fairly large introductory course, and so there are a large number of TAs. And so kind of whichever TAs were on campus and, you know, wanted to attend the lecture would just record it and then send it to all the other TAs. Because some people love working on campus. Some people would like to just get the lecture out of the way. Other people are like, that doesn't really fit into, you know, my rhythm of how I work, or I don't work well on campus, or, you know, in my case, I can go to campus. But the, yeah, and at that time, I didn't have my own vehicle, which is a whole other thing, because parking on campus should be free for disabled people. But anyway, I didn't have my own vehicle, so I was doing public transit both ways, and it destroyed me for, you know, that day and the whole next day just to go to listen to a 1-hour lecture, right? So the fact that she was like, oh no, this is just how we do it, it's no big deal, you know, and there was always someone to record the lecture. No one ever was like, this is such a burden, why do I have to do this, right? It was always someone was like, hey, I'll be there today, and then sent it out to the rest of the group. It was a non-issue. And so when it came to the next semester and my TA-ship, I reached out to the instructors a full month before the TA-ship started, and I said, you know, here's my situation, and here are some of the things that really helped me in the TA-ship that I just completed, which I, you know, completed successfully, had great student reviews. And the response that I got was, oh, we don't do that. Specifically, like, we don't record lectures. And I tried to be like, oh, it's actually, you know, helpfully, because at the time, I now have a better sense of like how these dynamics work, right? But at the time, I was like, maybe they don't know that it's so easy, right? I was like, let me be helpful. And so, oh, actually, it's very easy. Like, here's how it works. And I didn't realize that was not the issue. The issue, it was not a matter of like not knowing how, it was a matter of not wanting to know how.
The professors did not see Corin's request as reasonable. In fact, they told him that he should probably find another TA position. And this is where the language of what is reasonable can be used against disabled academics. But Corin knew that the university had a legal obligation to accommodate him. He emailed a number of people, his department chair, the grad chair, but was again met with dead ends. The semester was progressing, and he was having to commute 3 times a week to campus. His health was taking a hit. Then he requested a meeting with everybody present.
And so I emailed the department head, my supervisor, both professors, the grad chair, and my union representative, and said I would like a meeting with everybody present. And it was only at that point that that the department reached out to HR to be like, what do we do here? How do we accommodate this?
And 2 weeks before the school semester was over, Corin was called into a meeting with his department. I'll let him explain the rest.
And 2 weeks before the end of term, I get called into an administrator's office in our department with the department chair, the department head, and they said, you know, we have a form for you to sign to allow recording of this course. You literally just have to sign it and say, like, I'm not going to misuse these recordings. And that's it. That's all that it takes. Turns out this is such a common accommodation that HR already has a form typed up and ready to go. So this whole thing, this whole semester-long clusterfuck that resulted in me getting so much sicker, that resulted in me burning so many bridges with so many faculty members in my department, with my department leadership, could have been solved in an afternoon with a couple of emails back and forth with HR. So when I'm talking about time wasting, I'm talking about that. And it wasn't just that semester, because it wasn't just that issue, right? By that point, my health had been impacted to such an extent that I needed a full another semester to recover to where I had been. So all told, it was 2 semesters just because nobody did one afternoon of emails back and forth with HR.
Corin notes that many of his relationships with other people in his department have been harmed by the simple act of advocating for accommodations. I mentioned that it feels like we're viewed as disabled banshees, haunting the offices of tenured non-disabled professors, making an appearance every so often to screech about accommodations.
Yeah, totally. They would really prefer us to remain invisible.
Corin's time was wasted, and that time, he tells me, could have been used to do his research, improve his skills as an instructor, or put towards professional development, networking, and co-production of knowledge with other people. Moreover, it wasn't just time wasted, lost to the wind. It compounded. The process itself of waiting for accommodations further deteriorated his health, which now needed additional time simply to recover, to recoup back to where it was before making these requests. Here is Corin speaking about how much simpler things could have been, how much easier, if someone was there to do just one afternoon of emails back and forth with HR.
None of that gets to happen because somebody somewhere in the university didn't think disabled people existed. And so I have to spend hours and days and weeks emailing to assert my existence and my right to exist in this space. And it's just beyond frustrating.
These time-wasting loops, Corin continues, represent a complete failure to anticipate the presence and participation of disabled people. I ask him why some disabilities prove so unaccommodatable within academic institutions.
I feel like a lot of unaccommodatable symptoms come down to two things that the university really doesn't want to. Like, the accommodations are quite simple, but they're two things the university absolutely doesn't want to give anybody. And they are time and flexibility. And flexibility because we tend to know, as chronically ill and disabled people, how to navigate things like brain fog, how to navigate things like fatigue, how to navigate, you know, pain, variable disabilities of many sorts, right? And the tools that we use are often how we manage our time and our energy. And those things require the institution to be flexible and for the institution to change how it's oriented towards time. And it's so frustrating to me that there's this rigidity with respect to our time, but at the same time, we're supposed to just like sit back and let the whole process take as long as it takes, right? Like, we end up accommodating the institution, and it doesn't cost them, frankly, anything to be accommodating in terms of time, but it costs us so much to accommodate the institution and how the institution operates with respect to time. And I will say also that in terms of like difficult to accommodate things, the Center for Accessibility has I don't know if it's no idea how to accommodate grads' needs or like none of the resources and power within the institution in order to accommodate grads' needs, but things like, you know, our degrees take longer, but our funding isn't extended. So it's created this situation where my degree just drags on forever and ever. So it's like, you know, I can check out anytime I like, but I can never leave. I'm stuck in this, like, yeah. And when I've posed this to my accessibility advisor at the Center for Accessibility, I was told, well, that's not gonna change while you're here. So you need to figure out what to do with that. It's like, well, okay, so if the barriers that are keeping me from graduating aren't going to change while I'm still a student, but they're the thing that keeps me from graduating, like, how else am I supposed to leave? And I think you're just supposed to leave by quitting.
Leave by quitting. Maybe this is why there are so few disabled graduate students who make it to the end of their degrees. Our funding runs out. Our health gets worse. Our accommodations are denied or delayed. But there is a silver lining to all of this, he adds.
The one good thing about all of this is that I think I've been so annoying that they dread somebody else being equally annoying. And so, for instance, there's someone in my department who is just back from medical leave, has been dealing with some stuff, and the department has actually proactively offered the student some of the things that I haven't been able to get that I've been like, you need to give me this, but has already proactively offered them to the student to kind of be like, here, you have these things, we have this ready, we've got this all figured out, right? Which continues to suck for me, but makes me really happy to see that at least this student isn't getting the, oh, we've never dealt with this before, right? So if there's one silver lining, that may be it. Thank you.
Now let me offer up another story, this time from Nisha. Nisha went to business school, worked in politics, then returned to school for her MA. Now, she's pursuing an MFA in creative writing, also at my university. The program is almost entirely remote. Nisha is very creatively fulfilled by her program, and she tells me that education has changed her in fundamental ways. There is joy in what she does. Like me, Nisha also believes that disabled people hold knowledge that will liberate the rest of the world. Because of pain, Nisha uses voice-to-text software. Using the software is often time-consuming, and again brings up the question, how do we accommodate that? Here's Nisha.
And I've had a lot of problems because in a creative program like I'm in right now, a year ago, I kind of lost the ability to type and to hold a pen and do that type of creative work. And it took, I would say, a whole year and different programs to figure out how we even change what the basis of a graduate degree is, which is a lot of typing. You know, like I physically am in constant pain if I'm asked to do that kind of work. And if it takes a regular person, you know, 10 minutes to type out a thoughtful email, for me, if I'm doing text-to-speech off my phone's software, which I don't pay for, that'll take even more time to edit because the way you type and think is different. No one's really been able to accommodate that except for giving me, you know, a couple extra days here and there. But what they don't realize is that, like, even two extra days for a week-long assignment still results in like incredible pain, incredible crashes afterwards, long recovery periods. And so especially in courses where there's coursework due every week, this was not an accommodation that was offered to me, right? There wasn't an option to do, you know, let's do two in 1 week and then none for the next week, right? There was no way for people to really understand and accommodate pain. Now in the creative program, you know, even meeting with accessibility advisors, they had like told me that there's some software available that is better at text to speech. And when I went to look at the price, it was like $600 a year, you know, and I just don't have $600 a year to not be in pain. And so I didn't use the software in other classes. You know, eventually one of my profs like had suggested, especially for the interactive portions, like, you know, can you respond by video? But again, this was like such a narrow understanding of how pain and fatigue works, right? Because like, if I can't sit up to type, why would I be able to sit up to turn on my camera and look presentable and then film myself in like one take, right? And say everything I needed to.
Universities say they provide access to these services, things like note-taking, but that they are very often surface-level things, which don't address root issues with the way that classes are given. Why aren't lectures recorded and captioned? For what reasons aren't they? And when access is granted to individuals, on a restrictive case-by-case basis, it may draw unwanted attention.
I had like a suggestion last semester as well, where my participation was like being highly critiqued. I had been using text-to-speech software and I had been unable to edit out some of the mistakes in it. And a professor called me out as this was affecting, I think, in her opinion, the quality of my engagement with the class. And no one in the class had said anything. It was mostly just her perception of it, I would say. And instead of being like, okay, like, let's make it so that your word requirement is lower, or, you know, that like, we're going to give you more time to get typed out. No one pays for transcription either, of course, right? You pay for it yourself. Instead of having any of that, it was like, okay, well, since your grade is lower here, you can do these other five assignments for extra credit if you need to, if you want to bump up your mark. And I was like, so not only am I still doing the first assignments, and because you don't understand why I can't do them the way everyone else can do them, I've now been asked to do additional work.
I want to point out that the professor's concerns over the voiced text mistakes have nothing to do with Nisha's engagement. They have everything to do with attitudes.
If you're a student, here's your anti-ableist permission slip to refuse to work with faculty who make excuses for not providing access in their courses or when serving in advisory roles. If they wanted to, they would. If they don't want to, you're allowed to not want them.
I wondered what her dream scenario would look like in terms of access.
You know, I think like the dream scenario would be like, you know what? Like, I can't do all these assignments. I just can't. And it's not an issue of, do you want to do it later? Do you want to have an extra 3 days? And I'm like, 3 days is nothing in healing time for a chronically fatigued person or a chronically ill person. You know, I don't have access to the emergency rooms right now because they're full. And I spent most of December hovering on the cusp of like a very fatal diabetic ketoacidosis. And there was nothing to be done about that.
The other dream scenario, Nisha tells me, is to be able to take more time in the degree, to just have more time. The university needs to rethink its orientation towards time, or its suffocatingly narrow perceptions of productivity, pace, or time to degree. Assignments, expectations, engagement with knowledge would all benefit from slower temporal rhythms. Smaller class sizes, lighter teaching loads are needed. Nisha acknowledges that teachers need more resources and how they could make these shifts. No one is given the time to question their pedagogy, she tells me. These questions of rethinking time, of resources, of class sizes, of teaching loads, aren't isolated cases. They're all interconnected with the fact that universities often do not face the fact that they accept into their programs disabled students. They don't consider them in their day-to-day, let alone year-to-year operations. This isn't a set of individual, one-off issues, but an indication of an expectation of a certain type of able-bodied and able-minded student. For anyone else not fitting this one-size-fits-all approach, tough luck. Here's Corin again.
It's just tailoring the entire experience to not even the needs, but the interests of non-disabled graduate students, the interests of non-disabled faculty. And so just hearing over and over again, like, oh, we've never run into this situation before. We don't really know what to do here. This is kind of an exception. And it's like, well, you don't have to make the rules that way, right? Like, this is a series of choices, a series of policies that have been put in place, and they could have been made differently. They could have been made in ways that anticipated disabled people as part of the community, as part of the university, and that's not usually the case.
So how do we survive in a space that doesn't anticipate us being there? I asked the guests in this episode if they had advice for fellow disabled grad students, if they had anything that they wish they had known going into their respective programs.
I mean, the professors are key, and communication is key because, you know, obviously it puts some of the onus on you, but, you know, trusting that some of your teachers will listen to you, and that even if you get a weird, shitty answer from one of your teachers when you come to them about what you need, that just means, you know, that's one of the most important things that I never really got into when I was in undergrad and grad school, is like, you don't have to stay in a class. You can leave a class. There's systems built in for that. And, you know, so communicating and finding out, you know, that your teacher understands far outweighs the kind of like shittiness of realizing that your teacher doesn't, because you can leave those teachers that are shitty and go to those teachers that are good.
Yeah, great supervisor, be really obnoxious, helps to be a little bit dead inside in order to be that obnoxious. I think the third thing is community. Community is huge. And also knowing who's not your community. You know, there have been a couple of things, especially during the pandemic, then like, this person clearly doesn't care if I live or die. They're not my people. I have limited time and energy. I'm not going to spend it there. But yeah, supervision, being annoying, and finding your community, making your community if you have to.
So if you're disabled and you're trying to navigate grad school, I would say, like, take your time. If you want to do it part-time and you can, you should definitely do that. You should ask for help. You should, even if you don't get it, you know, at least the, I would like to think that eventually enough people are going to ask that it might benefit you or some, it might benefit someone else.
To conclude this episode, please enjoy Evan reading aloud their extended access statement from their syllabus. Thank you for listening.
While SAIC's approach to accommodations are a fantastic starting point and can allow those of us with the medical documentation and diagnosis to receive institutional accommodation, this will not be the case for all. To get one requires quote unquote proper diagnosis, and it also requires that we as faculty respect the accommodations in their fullness and that quote unquote reasonable accommodations can be crafted through conversations between us. Disability is not a neat and tidy category that can be fully encompassed within medical diagnostic frameworks. Part of our job as artists, and something that will come up as part of our class's research, is the interrogation of identity categories with an understanding that they are far more complex beyond the veil of quote unquote reason or reasonable. Disability scholars have given us many frameworks to understand disability, including the social model, the medical model, Tobin Sieber's theory of complex embodiment, the charity model, the biopsychosocial model, Alex Haggard's complicated model, which is still in development, Martha Russell's money model, and more. All have their drawbacks, but what this tells us is that how we understand disability through the medical legal model of diagnosis and institutional accommodations is going to be limited, and that is okay. These are both useful tools in their own way, but will not be accessible for everyone with a disability, me included, which means that part of this class requires a conversation about what it looks like when we acknowledge accommodations outside of the institutional and the reasonable, as well as how they structure the way we make and create and think. This does not require disclosure of illness or disability by any of you, but rather that communications will be had about how to make the classroom accessible to all. And importantly, accessibility is not strictly confined to questions of disability and illness, and is wrapped up with the realities of other identity categories as well. As with the other ways in which we engage in intersectional politics in the classroom, it is necessary to consider those elements which seem second nature to us. As the COVID-19 pandemic has made abundantly clear, illness and disability cannot be removed from the conversations we have. As the Harriet Tubman Collective, a group of Black, deaf, and disabled activists, wrote in Disability Solidarity, Completing the Vision for Black Lives, quote, "The Harriet Tubman Collective submits that any struggle against white supremacy must be an intersectional struggle against all systems of discrimination, including ableism and autism. Organizations that label themselves intersectional must genuinely pursue disability justice," end quote. This section of the syllabus is both to get us thinking about how identity and our understanding of it will fold into our research goals, but also to give those of you who need it support in advocating for your access needs, both this semester and in semesters to come. And then I have a Bob Flanagan poster next to a Beatrice Etherbolt painting.